Here begins videotape number one in the deposition of Michelle Krupa Shaw in the matter of,
In the matter of Kevin Tolson versus St. Agnes Healthcare Incorporated et al. In the Circuit Court for Baltimore City, case number 24C12008071. Today's date is August 9th, 2013. The time on the video monitor is 10 a.m. And the video operator today is Akeem Graham. This video deposition is taking place at 7 St. Paul Street in Baltimore, Maryland. Counsel, please voice identify yourselves and state whom you represent.
Robbie M. Gaston, I represent the plaintiff, Kevin Tolson.
Robert H. Bass, Jr., on behalf of Ms. Krupa and Dr. Prudence Jackson.
Mary Pat McGuire on behalf of Caroline Still and St. Agnes Hospital.
The court reporter today is Trish Mitchell of Merrill Ladd. Would the reporter please swear in the witness?
Would you raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear into the penalties of perjury? The testimony you give will be the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
Yes.
Ma'am, could you please state your full name and work address and home address, please?
My full name is Krupa Pratik Shah. And my home address is 135 Arbor Vista Lane, Owings Mills, Maryland 21117. And currently I'm not working.
Okay. And Ms. Shaw, my name is Rodney Gaston and I represent Mr. Tolson in an action that's currently pending in the Circuit Court for Baltimore City. This action is a claim for medical malpractice arising out of the treatment Mr. Tolson received at St. Agnes Hospital Emergency Room on December 3rd, 2009. Have you ever had your deposition taken before?
No.
Okay. I'm going to just go over some of the ground rules so we can get through this and so that all of the questions and answers can be recorded clearly and accurately. The court reporter is here to take down the questions and also take down your answers. Even though it's being videotaped, the court reporter can't take down both of us talking at the same time. In normal conversation, it's very usual for persons to interrupt each other during normal conversations, but I would ask, for the purposes of the deposition today, that you wait until after I finish asking my question before you answer, and then I'll try not to interrupt you. Also, if at any time during the deposition you do not understand the question that I ask, you have to stop me immediately and let me know, and I'll try to rephrase the question. Otherwise, if you don't do that, we will assume that you've understood the question and that you've answered it appropriately. Have you understood everything I said so far?
Yes.
Okay. Ma'am, where were you born?
Bhavnagar, India. You want me to spell it?
The country's fine. India?
India. Mm-hmm.
And when were you born?
October 11th, 1979.
Is English your primary language?
Gujarati is my primary language, but English I understand very well.
Right, you don't have any problem understanding the words that I'm saying today, right?
No. I'm totally educated in English medium, so.
Very good, thank you. Okay, and when did you come to the United States?
I came in 2004.
2004. And ma'am, your counsel was kind enough to provide me with a copy of your resume or CV. Mm-hmm. Which we have marked as exhibit number one. You have a copy of that with you, so you can refer to that at any time.
Okay.
Is this a accurate, does exhibit number one accurately reflect your education and your work experience?
Yes.
Okay. Do you hold any licenses or certifications in the field of physician assistant medicine?
Yeah, I am a licensed physician assistant.
And what state are you licensed in?
Maryland.
And do you know when you obtained that license?
2008.
Have you been continuously licensed in the state of Maryland since 2008?
Yes.
Have you ever held licenses in the field of physician assistant medicine in any other states or any other countries?
No.
Do you hold any other professional licenses or certifications?
Yeah, I am a homeopathic physician from India.
I'm sorry?
Homeopathic physician from India, so I do have that license.
Is that a license that you sought to receive when you moved to the United States?
Before that, I had that license. I immediately finished my studies of homeopathic medicine in India, and I came to United States.
Okay. Can you tell me a little bit about homeopathic medicine and how that relates or doesn't relate to other fields of medicine?
Homeopathy is a medication which is different from the allopathic medication. In a way, it more individualizes. Like this homeopathy is different for every person, every individual. It's not the same for all of us. And it's similar in a way that we study all the subjects that allopathic medication is, like anatomy, physiology, and all the routine subjects. We go in equal detail. Plus, we have our own pharmacopoeia, a different pharmacopoeia that we go through.
Obtaining your degree in homeopathic medicine in the country of India, were you allowed to prescribe medications for patients?
Homeopathic medication, yes.
And does that include narcotic medications?
No.
Okay, I'm just trying to figure out what types of medications that you were allowed to prescribe.
We have a total different, like, herbal medication field in which we do give medications, but I mean, it's not based on narcotics, or it's not based on the allopathic distribution of medicines. It's very different.
Okay.
Excuse me, Michelle, would you mind moving your microphone up higher? I think it slid down a little bit.
Good?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Okay. What medications are you allowed to prescribe in accordance with your physician assistant license in the state? In the United States in the state of Maryland.
We are allowed to prescribe all the medications.
All medications?
Uh-huh.
So any I'm sorry. I didn't know if you were finished your answer or not.
Yeah, we can prescribe controlled drug substances and...
So you do not need a physician's permission to prescribe pain medication or narcotic medication in the emergency room setting. Would that be true?
We do not, but we generally prescribe it in accordance with them. They do watch what we prescribe, but yes, it's not necessary that a physician has to watch that.
Okay. Now, in accordance with the deposition today, I did send a notice of deposition to your attorney. He does have a copy of that notice, and your attorney can assist you with answering the next question. But the deposition notice contained a list of approximately 27 items for you to produce at the deposition, and I'm wondering if you brought any of those items with you today.
For the record, and I indicated part of the deposition started, Ms. Hall does not have, other than her CV, any other documents to be produced. All the records that we obtained from St. Agnes Hospital. She does not have any of her own notes or records in the care and treatment of Mr. Tolson at St. Agnes Hospital on December 3rd, 2009. The rest of the documents will be produced if the call for it through discovery, if they haven't been already.
I'm particularly concerned because we will have expert depositions coming up within the next 4 weeks. Any demonstrative evidence or exhibits pertaining to the issues in the case that are to be relied upon by any expert witnesses, because I would like to get a copy of those before the experts are deposed. So if they exist now, if you could tell me if they do, and if they could be produced.
From right now, on behalf of my clients, I don't have any of such exhibits at this point. If they are, and my experts are going to use them in response to your questions or in their testimony, I will certainly produce them before the deposition takes place.
Thank you, Counselor. I appreciate that. Okay. Ms. Shaw, one of the main reasons that I've asked you here today is because if this case goes to trial and you're called as a witness by either side, and you're asked on the witness stand to provide any opinions that you have in this case, the reason I'm here today is to find out the opinions that you intend to tell the jury, the opinions that you have, intend to tell the jury, and all of the reasons, the factual basis behind those opinions. So I'm asking you that question now. Can you tell me, and we can go through a list of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the opinions that you have now and/or intend to provide at the time of this trial?
Mr. Gaston, Ms. Shaw is not going to render any expert opinion. She will answer questions now around the stand as to her care and treatment, Mr. Tolson, when she saw him on December 3rd, 2009, as indicated in the medical records of St. Agnes Hospital, and her recollection.
Okay. Thank you. Ms. Shaw, do you have an independent recollection of treating Kevin Tolson on December the 3rd, 2009?
I just recollect that I saw that patient on December 3rd.
Is this in your own memory that you're thinking back now, or is this based upon your review of the chart?
It's mostly review of the chart, and certain things I do remember.
What I'm trying to figure out is, can you tell me what things you yourself in your own mind can remember that's not based upon the chart? We'll take care of that first, and then we'll talk about what things you remember based upon the chart. So for your own memory, excluding the chart, what can you tell me about your own memory and your own mind about the treatment you provided Kevin Tolson?
If you can separate it out, that's what he's asking you.
Okay. I cannot separate it that much. No, I cannot. I just remember a very small basic thing, like he was just sitting in the room next to us, and he was accompanied by a lady.
All right. Do you remember whether he was a white gentleman or African-American
gentleman? He was African-American.
Okay. So you remember him just sitting in a room with a lady?
Yes.
Okay. Do you remember any specifics? Okay. Is that the extent of your own recollection separate and apart from the file?
Yes.
Okay. Now I want to go, now I'm going to let you use the file, the chart that you have in front of you, mm-hmm. that's marked as exhibit number 2. I believe.
Page 1 of 6.
And the first page.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. We have exhibit number 2. And before we go into that, can you tell me when you first started working at St. Agnes Hospital?
In 2009.
2009. Were you an employee of the hospital or employee of some other concern?
Some other, like MCARE.
Okay. You were employed by MCARE?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so MCARE hired you mm-hmm. to perform services as a physician assistant at St. Agnes Hospital Emergency Room. Would that be a fair statement?
Yes.
Okay.
For the record, Mr. Gaston, I know we say MCARE, and you've
seen
the
contract. I'm sorry.
It's Maryland Pro V1 Medical Services PC.
Thanks. I'll accept counsel's proffer. For you.
Thank you very much.
That's okay. Now, when you went to work at St. Agnes, were you given any sets of rules, regulations, protocols that applied to how physician's assistants were supposed to provide medical care for patients in the emergency room?
Objection, foundation?
It was just, I guess, the legal stuff. But I don't think, they didn't explain to us like, okay, this is the way you have to treat the patient, no.
Okay, so they didn't sit down with you and give you step-by-step instructions
right.
as to the protocols that the hospital expected you to follow when you treated a patient in the emergency room, is that correct?
Objection.
I don't remember that.
Okay, and as far as I know, no such documents have been produced, so would it be fair to say that you don't have any documents if any documents ever existed? Would that be a fair statement?
I don't know about that. I cannot comment on that because I don't remember at the top of. There was a whole bunch of things provided, but I don't know what exactly was in it.
Okay.
For the record, we don't have any on behalf of Maryland Pro V1 Medical Services okay. PC.
Thank you. Okay. Can you tell me how the emergency room is set up at St. Agnes Hospital?
It is divided into the main.
Objection as to time frame?
Well, unless I say otherwise, all of my questions are going to pertain to December 3rd, 2009, so that we understand. And that's the time period that we're talking about. So, okay. In December of 2009, can you tell me how the emergency room at St. Agnes Hospital was set up?
It has two sections, the main emergency and urgent care. And That's the way it is divided. I was working in urgent care section on that day.
Okay. And did you ever work in the main emergency room at St. Agnes?
Yes, I did.
Okay. So how would you know when you went into work whether you were going to be assigned to the main emergency room or to the urgent care department?
We used to get our schedule beforehand.
Okay. So before December of 2009, would it be fair to say that you had experience working in both the main emergency room at St. Agnes Hospital and the emergency care department at St. Agnes mm-hmm. Hospital?
Yeah, I started in 2009 at both the places.
Both yes. places, okay. Now, can you tell me how the emergency care department is set up? How it's staffed?
Urgent. Is it urgent care? Or?
I was working in urgent care on that day.
You keep saying emergency
care. Thank you. We'll talk about urgent care. Can you tell me how the urgent care department was set up in December of 2009?
Set up, there's a physician and a PA and I think one or two nurses assigned to us. And for the PAs, it was two shifts, morning and evening. I was working, I'm not sure on that day. I think I was working in the evening shift that day.
And when does the morning shift start?
I think morning was starting, it was in between shift or morning. I do not recollect exactly, but I think the morning shift started with around, I'm not able to exactly recollect the timings because I have not worked too many morning shifts in urgent care, so I don't remember the times.
Okay, when would your evening shift in urgent care start?
It was 2 to 12 sometimes, or 1 to 11.
And that would be 1 o'clock in the afternoon or 2 o'clock in the afternoon until 11 12. O'clock at night?
Or 12.
Or midnight?
Uh-huh.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I forgot to also tell you that all of your responses have to be verbal. We can't take down a shake of the head or a nod. Thank you very much. Oh, and if you want to take a break at any time, just let us know for any reason. We'll let you take a break. Now, who would do the initial triage for a patient who would be brought into the emergency room either by ambulance or by walk-in?
Initially, the nurse outside, they do the triage. And they decide where the patient will go, on the main side or on the urgent care.
Okay. Did you in this case have any hand in determining the level of triage that was assigned to Mr. Tolson?
No.
Okay. If a nurse outside of the emergency room, talking about emergency room generally, decides a particular category of triage for a patient, and decides the patients to go to emergent care side where you are, if you decide that the patient should be at a higher level of triage and go over to the main emergency room, could you make that decision?
Object. Go ahead, you answer. I'm just directing the form of the question.
Yeah,
you're fine.
Urgent care. Yeah.
And have you ever done that while you were working at St. Agnes?
Yes.
All right. So when you receive the patient, you initially check to see whether or not the correct triage level has been assigned. If you believe the patient should be at a higher level of triage to go to the main emergency room, you would make that decision and then have the patient, quote, transferred to the main emergency room for treatment. Would that be a fair statement?
I object again. You can.
Yeah, I don't see the triage level all the time. I just go and see the patient myself, and if I feel that patient is not fit for urgent care, we make a transfer to the emergency room.
And that's part of your evaluation?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, okay, thank you. All right, now, are there different forms that are used by the main emergency room versus the urgent care department?
Mm-hmm. Ron, you're talking about hospital forms? That's it.
Yeah, okay. Hospital forms.
No.
They're the same?
Yes.
Okay. There is a form I wanted to ask you about that's not contained in your document, and it's page 3.
I've got it.
Counsel, I think each of you.
This one with the big X?
It's the one with the X on it. Yes, ma'am, and I'll show it to you right here on my iPad.
Oh,
counsel has it. Thank you.
I have no idea. I think this is a nursing assessment form, maybe, because we don't fill this form.
Okay, when you say we, can you be a little more specific? Because this is a form that's contained in Mr. Tolson's chart that was sent to us by the hospital. Do you know who made that X on the form?
No.
Okay. And is this a nursing assessment form?
That's what I think it is.
Have you ever used this form in an evaluation of a patient?
No.
Okay. And you do not know why this form is put in the chart, in Mr. Tolson's chart?
Yes, I do not know.
Okay. Now, can you tell me from the chart on page 2 of the chart, whose handwriting is that?
No.
Does that mean it's not yours?
Mm-hmm.
You have to.
It's not mine.
It's not mine. There's an RN where it says triage RN nurse.
Yes.
Do you know that nurse? It's like B-E-S-I-L-E. Do you have any idea who that nurse is?
No.
Okay. All right. And is this the adult triage that's done by the nurse before the patient is actually sent to the urgent care department?
Yes.
Okay. Now, when you reviewed conducted the examination of Mr. Tolson, did you have this form available to you to review?
Yes.
Okay. Do you know whether or not you looked at this form or not?
Yes, I quickly skim it.
Okay, all right. And page 4, do you know who put the information on that page?
No.
Are they your initials?
This one, right? Page 4.
Yes, ma'am. Page 4.
This all initial that you're talking about?
Yes, ma'am. It's in the sort of like the middle to bottom half on the right-hand side. It says comfort measure, date 12-3, and it has initial over to the side. Are those your initials?
No.
Do you know whose initials they are?
No.
Do you know which person, nurse, doctor, physician's assistant, would normally fill out that portion of the chart?
No.
Do you know if this is a triage or whether this is actually a physical examination?
This is this is just the order form.
Okay.
What was ordered.
It looks like there were x-rays ordered on this form,
yes.
Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know who ordered the x-rays?
Dr. Prudence ordered it.
Dr. Jackson orders the x-rays?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. And page 5, is that an order form as well?
Yes.
Okay. And looks like dilaudid, 1 milligram by IV?
Yes.
And looks like Toradol by IV as well?
Yes.
And do you know who ordered those medications for Mr. Tolson?
Dr. Jackson, Stevens Jackson.
Thank you. Page number 7. Can you tell me what that report pertains to?
This is the discharge done by Caroline Stell.
Okay. Is Ms. Stell a nurse in the urgent care department at the hospital?
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell me what basically Ms. Stell's responsibility is for discharging the patient?
Objection.
What she does?
If you know.
They generally follow the instruction, whatever we have written on the chart, like if we have asked to give the crutches or immobilizer, they do that. And that's all we know, that they do that part of it. After that,
okay.
Not sure.
Would it be fair to say whatever discharge instructions that you found were appropriate for the patient, mm-hmm. himself, the discharge nurse would have to then convey those instructions to the patient before the patient was allowed to leave the hospital?
Objection to form the foundation.
I think they must be doing that and plus their own assessment at the end of the, when the patient leaves.
Okay.
But definitely what we instruct them.
Okay. And do they do an independent assessment right before the patient is discharged?
If you know.
Same objections to form and foundation.
Yeah, I can't say it for sure.
Well, based upon your knowledge and experience in working in the emergency room, do they also
mostly
do an assessment?
Yeah.
Same objection.
Go ahead.
Nurses, they always do that.
Now, page 8. Do you know whose handwriting is on that page?
This is all me.
All you. Okay. Can you read each of the words on those lines for me, if you would?
Yes.
out loud. I'm sorry.
It starts from the beginning, like the nurse's note was reviewed with the check mark there.
Oh, that's you checking nurse's notes reviewed and agreed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, go right ahead, ma'am.
And then it says the chief complained left leg trauma at work.
Okay.
Leg trauma at work, left. 49-year-old male complained of left leg got caught up in a barrier door with sharp pain, 7 out of 10. Continuous pain, no ambulation, positive for numbness, positive paresthesia.
Okay. And what is the time?
On 4.
Did you know if that's 4 o'clock or 4:09?
It's 4 o'clock.
4 o'clock. Okay. So would it be fair to say that you saw Mr. Tolson at 4 o'clock mm-hmm. on December the 3rd, 2009?
Yes.
You conducted a physical examination of him, and you made these notes that you just read to us in the chart following that physical examination?
This is the history that we do first. After the history, we go on the physical exam.
Okay. When it says positive for numbness, do you know what part of Mr. Tolson's body he complained was numb at that time?
He was just complaining a very vague numbness feeling of the whole left leg.
And positive for, what is that word?
Paresthesias.
Okay, now, I'm presuming Mr. Tolson didn't use the word paresthesias.
Yeah.
Is that your interpretation of what he told you?
Yes, he just said some tingling he felt.
Tingling?
Mm-hmm.
Is paresthesia used to describe an inability to move a body part?
No.
Okay, so paresthesias, when you wrote this, is only tingling. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. At that point, before you examined him, did you have an idea or a suspicion where the numbness and tingling was in what part of his body? I think you said the whole left leg is
yeah.
Would that be fair?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Now, what was your understanding of how he was injured, other than caught up in a barrier door? Do you have any idea what type of door, how it injured him, or anything else other than caught up in a barrier door?
As far as my understanding, I thought that the door actually came on him, and the door dropped on his leg.
Indicating a downward motion. It's on a tape.
Yeah, and would this be an overhead door that you see at sometimes loading docks, a large overhead door that would come down and then had struck him on his leg? Is that your understanding of his injury?
Objection, if you know.
A door, no, I don't know. It's just a door. I don't know, a large door or a small door.
Did you make any further inquiry of him to determine the size of the door, whether it was a small door, large door, or the actual mechanism of how the door came down on his leg?
We always ask that. That's the first question I ask the patient about the mechanism of injury, and that's what he told me. That's what I have written in the chart.
And why is it important to learn the mechanics of the injury as an emergency room physician's assistant?
It is absolutely important to know which will drag you for the treatment and diagnostic options.
Right. It helps to point you in the right direction with respect to the type of injuries that you might be looking for and the location of the injuries on the patient's body. Would that be a fair statement?
I object. Go ahead, Doctor.
Yeah.
Ms. Shaw.
Now, did you then conduct a physical examination of Mr. Tolson?
This is a whole of the review of system and put in summary. In review of system, we ask everything.
Now, this on page, we're still on page 8?
Yes.
Okay, if you can go over the box, because the words are kind of hard for me to discern. You might be.
This is a whole past medical history on the left side.
Okay.
Allergies, marital status, social history.
Right, and I think you circled the word none.
Yes.
So it would be fair to say there was no past medical history that was pertinent to the examination that you were about to conduct on Mr. Tolson?
It is past medical history is in general, whatever he suffered in the past.
Okay. What's the box underneath of that?
Well, yeah, this is not a very clear print.
No, let me see if my copy's clear.
The box under what?
The box directly under past medical history.
I can't make it out of the three.
It appears to be an SHX.
Social history? Underneath that will be a social history where it says marital status and
circled
occupation.
None.
Yeah.
Okay. Underneath that, meds, did you also check none?
Marital status, med, yes. And
okay.
Family.
Underneath that, is it allergies?
None.
Okay. All right. Now, moving over to the other side.
This states the constitution of the patient, whether the patient had any fever, any chills. Then it's all systems, the rest CNS system, whether the patient was confused, dizzy, which patient denies.
Okay.
Then we go on eyes, whether he had any blurred vision, that patient denies. Then it's ENT, if he had any those issues, he denies. Then it's the respiratory. If he had any of those issues, patient denies. Then it was cardiovascular, where he denies any chest pain, any cold extremity, any claudication, leg swelling that he denied. Then it's the gastrointestinal, which he denies any abdominal pain. And then I think it's the allergies.
Oh, back up a second.
Yeah.
Was there some type of pain that he related when you asked him about whether he had any neck pain, leg pain, or other pain?
Yes, he said that he had leg pain in the musculoskeletal.
In the musculoskeletal box.
Musculoskeletal box. Okay. He had leg pain. What other pain did he report?
I was going on the foot. That's why I said other pain.
Oh, the foot. Okay,
the foot and the ankle. He was complaining in general of the whole left extremity pain.
All right. Continue down the box underneath of that.
I think it is skin, which he denied any complaint. And then think old intolerance, heat intolerance, that he didn't have any. And then it's psychological anxiety or.
Okay. All right. So all of the boxes that we just talked about is what the patient would tell you after you ask them a question about those particular mm-hmm. areas. Would that be a fair statement?
Yes.
Okay. Now, is page 9 where your actual examination begins?
Yes.
Okay. and was this somewhere close to 4:00 in the afternoon?
It should be.
Okay. Okay. And what did your examination of Mr. Tolson reveal?
That patient was alert and oriented. And we just quickly go over the eyes and the ENT part, the cardiovascular, we quickly go over. And then we come on the musculoskeletal, where I started describing myself.
Go right ahead, ma'am. If you could explain what you wrote, your handwriting on the form, you could explain that for us.
It says at left knee, there was swelling. And it was tender on palpation with limited range of motion.
Can you tell us now how limited the motion was based upon your memory or this report?
I cannot remember.
Do you usually write the degrees of the range of motion or the limitations on your report?
I generally write it down as limited range of motion.
Does it matter to you in your evaluation of the patient whether the range of motion is limited to the form of minimal, moderate, or severe?
I generally write limited range of motion, and if it's because overall the patient, because of the level of injury, we were going to x-ray the patients and check the neurovascular status. So generally I you should write limited range of motion.
Back to my original question. Does it matter for the further evaluation of the patient whether the range of motion is minimal, moderate, or severe?
I object. I think she answered, but go ahead, Michelle.
And I don't think so.
So as long as your evaluation is limited, then you would then take all of the next steps for the evaluation.
Right.
So it doesn't matter if it's limited, moderate, severe. You're still going to take the very next steps for
yes.
each patient. Okay, thank you. All right. Now, when you say limited, was that the knee or the foot?
At that time, I was talking about the knee.
The knee. Okay, go right ahead.
Then I went into the left leg and ankle.
Okay.
And which was also tender on palpation with swelling. Less full range of motion, negative full range of motion.
I'm sorry, negative for range of motion, does that mean there was is it negative full range of motion?
Yes.
Does that mean he did not have full range of motion?
He was not having full range of motion on my exam.
Okay, and that was for the foot and the ankle?
Yes.
All right, and can you tell me again the degree of the limitation of the range of motion in the foot and the ankle?
I cannot remember.
Okay. Do you ever put that in the chart or you just write limited?
Yeah, I just write limited.
Okay, and what's underneath of that?
That there were pulses were present on both the feet.
Okay, and do you know how you quantified that?
It was 2+.
2+, and what are the various degrees of pulses that you can write?
It goes from 0 to 4.
0 to 4, and 0 obviously means no pulse.
Right.
Okay, what does 1 mean?
1 means they are not detectable.
Not detectable, and what does 2 mean?
2 and 3, they go together. For me in the ER, because generally patients 2+ is detectable, 3+ is normal, and 4 is bounding.
Okay, so in this case, because you used a 2 versus a 3, would you believe that your evaluation of the pulse was somewhat, he had a pulse, but it was somewhat less than normal?
No.
Okay, then I didn't understand you. I thought you said
2+ and 3+, they are very commonly used pulse demarcation in the ER, and plus sometimes if okay I felt a 2+, I would go ahead and check it in the normal extremity, and at the same it felt exactly the same on that side. So doesn't matter if it's 2+ or 3+, it was same in both the extremities, and every individual might have a little bit of 2+ or 3+. Doesn't mean anything.
Okay, what I'm trying to understand is 3+ normal from your understanding and the terms that you use?
I can't say that. It's not a book picture here.
I'm sorry?
It's not a book picture, clear cut. So I cannot say whether 2+ is normal or 3+ is normal.
Okay, in this case, were you able to render an opinion one way or the other whether 2+ was normal in this case or less than normal?
It was normal in this case.
Normal in this case. All right, now, when you mean, all right, now, the nurse on triage on page 2 noted a deformity.
Yeah, I don't know what that was.
Was the knee deformed by virtue of swelling?
It was swollen, that's what I've written, so. But it was, I don't recall any deformity. Like,
okay.
It was dislocated, or I don't know.
Okay. Now, the pulses that you checked, were they, where were they on his body? Did you check the
on
foot?
On the feet.
Foot?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, did you check the pulses anywhere else in Mr. Tolson's body?
Just the foot and the ankle, the posterior tibial and the dorsalis pedis.
All right. Now, the triage nurse indicated that Mr. Tolson was unable to move his left foot. Is that what you also found upon your examination?
He was not having full range of motion. He was able to wiggle the toes and I don't exactly remember like what he was able to do, but it was not like he was absolutely not able to move.
Okay. When you have a patient that came in who was examined by the nurse, and when she wrote he's unable to move his foot, but when you examined him, he had some motion of his foot. Did you render a medical diagnosis at that time as to why he was unable to move his foot when the nurse examined him, but able to have motion when you examined him? Were you able to render that diagnosis at that time?
Object. Go ahead.
Objection.
It's very subjective. I mean, patient at that time, a little bit of motion or no motion doesn't mean anything. As I said previously, that we were going to test him. We were going to look for fractures, x-rays. So to my thing, if he had a little bit of motion, if it did not have, doesn't mean much at that point of time.
Doesn't mean much at that point, because you were going to go ahead and do your regular examination testing.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Did you, at the time when you did your physical examination, did you have an idea or a suspicion what might have been causing Mr. Tolson originally to be unable to move his foot, or when you examined him to have a limited range of motion in his foot?
Objection.
He had an injury to his leg. So initially he could not have moved, but now he is able to move a little bit. So, I mean.
What I'm trying to figure out, did you ever reach a diagnosis in your own mind or in the chart as to what was causing the inability of Mr. Tolson to move his foot when he was in the emergency?
No, Jack, I think she explained it. Go ahead, Sean.
Yeah, that's what I said, that he could have fractured, he could have dislocations, he could have, that's why we were going to give him the care that he needed on that day.
Eventually, were you able to reach a diagnosis or a conclusion as to why he was unable to initially move his foot when he came into the emergency room? After you did all your evaluation, were you then able to reach a diagnosis?
Object.
Yeah, that's why on that particular day, we thought the rest of his x-rays were negative and he had good pulses. So we thought it could be a sprain, and we asked him to come back to the ER if it felt worse or follow up with his orthopedics.
Okay. Mr. Tolson reported numbness and tingling. Did you ever ask him again, other than 4 o'clock, whether he continued to have numbness or tingling in his leg or foot before he was discharged?
Yes.
Okay, when did you ask him again after the initial evaluation that was done at 4 o'clock with respect to numbness and tingling?
On page 10.
Page 10.
Where it was checkmarked. After the splint was applied, during the time of discharge, one of us, we go and we always check the neurovascular, which was performed and was intact.
Neurovascular, can you describe what neurovascular in the medical terms means, what a neurovascular examination is?
Mainly the pulses, where the patient, how the leg felt to us, and in the term of patient's pain.
Okay. And who did that evaluation?
It could be done, these are my initials, but it could be done either by me, Caroline, or Dr. Jackson.
Okay. But according to this chart, it looks like you're the one who did the neurovascular assessment after the splint was applied, correct?
Yes.
Okay. What type of splint was applied to Mr. Tolson's leg?
It was a left knee immobilizer.
Left knee immobilizer?
Mm-hmm.
And how short or how long is that immobilizer brace?
Caroline applied it.
Caroline, Ms. Steele applied it?
Uh-huh.
All right. And can you tell me how short or how long it was?
I don't remember that.
Can you tell me what part of the upper part of his knee the brace covered, what part of the underside of his knee the brace covered?
I don't remember that.
Can you tell me how far down along the knee the brace covered?
I can't. remember that.
All right. And your neurovascular assessment was done after this brace was placed on his knee, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Would it be fair to say that at the time of discharge, Mr. Tolson was not able to weight bear on his left leg?
Yes, we didn't try that either.
So you didn't ask him to put any weight on his left leg or knee?
Yeah, yes.
Is that because he was in so much pain you didn't want to cause him any further pain?
I object.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Now, what other physical examination did you perform on Mr. Tolson to determine the nature of the injury to his knee?
To his knee, Ron, I didn't hear
to his knee, yes, to his knee.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I generally start with inspection and then I palpate and then we ask them to do the range of motion and then we go with the pulses.
Okay. How did you test range of motion in Mr. Tolson's knee? Is there a particular orthopedic test that you use? Can you tell me what you did?
I did not. I just asked him to move his knee, and I did not give any pressure because I didn't know whether he had any fractures, any dislocations. I didn't want to injure him more. So I just asked him to move it and saw what he was able to do.
Okay. Now, did you make a note of the skin temperature anywhere in the chart?
It was in the review of system that it his feet or his leg was not cold.
Where is this note noted in the chart?
On page 8.
On page 8? Okay, where on page 8 did it indicate that you actually tested the temperature in his leg and indicated that it wasn't cool or cold?
My physical exam, I was constantly palpating the patient's whole leg. I was feeling the patient. So if it was cold, I would have gone ahead and done things which would have helped me to go in further direction. But definitely his leg was not cold.
But it's not noted, not specifically noted in the chart.
Again, that was not necessary because we were constantly palpating.
But the answer is it's not specifically noted in the chart.
Objection, except you testified on page 8, it's there.
Okay, where on page 8 does it say that the temperature in his leg was normal or warm?
It just says whether it was cold extremity or not, and there was no cold extremity.
Okay, where is that? What
under,
box, ma'am?
If you see the cardiovascular, under that all organ system, just under that check mark.
Okay, could you circle that box? Because I can't read the words there. If you could circle the entire box that you say relates to the temperature of the leg. Okay, thank you. All right, it's the second column from the right-hand side of the page.
Mm-hmm.
The one, two, third box down?
Yes.
On page 8. Okay. Now, it says he denies chest pain, hallucination, cold extremity, leg swelling, or palpation. Is that correct?
Palpitations, yes.
Okay. But that doesn't indicate your examination. That just indicates what the patient told you, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what my question is, where in this chart did you write that based upon your examination, his leg was warm, cool, or cold? Does that appear anywhere in his chart?
I object. Go ahead.
Again, I mean, I was palpating his leg all the time. So that was always in my mind, that whether I'm feeling cold, whether the patient is not able to feel my touch, it was all constantly there in my mind.
I understand so. It's in your mind, but I'm trying to figure out if what is in your mind you wrote on this chart.
Yeah, but I mean that I don't think that has anything to do with the treatment we gave to the patient.
But again, back to my original question, what you had in your mind regarding the temperature of his leg, is that noted anywhere in the chart in writing?
I object.
No, I don't see that in the chart, but I mean, it was, again, We were constantly on, my hand was constantly on the patient's whole extremity.
Okay, you also indicated if there was a complaint of a cool or cold extremity by the patient or based upon your examination, you would have done something different for the patient, correct?
It again depends. Again, only the cold extremity, it doesn't mean anything. We have to put the overall picture together.
Okay. Simply that a person has a cold foot doesn't mean anything in and of itself for this patient?
Yes.
Yes, meaning?
Doesn't mean.
Doesn't mean anything to you in and of itself?
Mean, yeah.
Okay. I think you said you didn't actually move Mr. Tolson's leg yourself to determine the range of motion or to determine if there was instability in his knee. You simply asked him to move it and you made a note of what he was able to do. Is that a fair
right.
statement? Okay. When you evaluate a patient, I'm sorry, do you believe that Mr. Tolson sustained a traumatic injury to his knee?
I object.
I can't say. I mean, it's.
Do you understand? Did you learn the word trauma in your education?
Yes.
Do you have an understanding of what the word trauma means in the medical sense?
Trauma could be in different sense.
Okay. Do you understand what the word traumatic injury in this situation means?
The traumatic injury means that a door had fallen on his leg, which was a trauma to his leg.
That's what I indicated, whether you believe he sustained a traumatic injury to his knee, do you now believe that he did?
Yes.
Okay. Now, were you able to, before you did the x-rays, were you able to quantify the traumatic injury to his knee, such as what structures may have been damaged, what muscles may have been damaged, what ligaments may have been damaged, what tendons may have been damaged, or what blood vessels may have been damaged?
This is before the x-ray?
Before the x-ray.
Object, go ahead.
Before the x-ray, we generally, I was thinking of fracture dislocations, and that's why the whole series of x-rays were ordered.
Based upon his complaints of numbness and his inability to move his foot, did it also cross your mind that he may have sustained a vascular injury?
Numbness is extremely common in the patients who has this kind of an injury to describe that my leg is numb.
And what would the causes of the extremely common complaint of numbness be in these types of patients?
Just from the mechanism of injury.
Okay. Was it a injury to the nerves that result in numbness?
Yes.
Okay, and could also numbness result from a decrease in the flow of blood to the extremity?
It can be from anything, but it is very common when patient has anything fallen on their foot to feel I'm numb for a little while, and then again that's the reason we do the neurovascular assessment at the end when the patient leaves, and we ask them whether they do feel the same way. Because initially, after the injury, it's very common for them to feel that.
Is it common to feel that because of peripheral nerves or damage, or is it also common because some of the blood vessels may all have been temporarily traumatized?
Object.
It could be anything.
Could be anything? Okay. Now, how do you rule out whether it's trauma to peripheral nerves, trauma to blood vessels, that results in numbness? You as a physician's assistant, how do you rule that out in the emergency room? What tests do you usually?
Mainly we check the pulses.
Check the pulses?
Mm-hmm. And we check the pulses, we compare it to the other extremity, and again we check it during the time when the patient leaves till the time patient was there. Is there any diminution in the pulses? Is there any change what they felt when they came in? And in that way, further we go from there.
Okay. Where in the chart did you indicate his pulses were a +2 after your initial evaluation I didn't
see
that.
It's just the same checkbox that his neurovascular assessment on page 10.
Right, but there's nothing in there about you didn't quantify what his pulses were, is that correct?
But I mean, it's still the same. It was not that it had gone below or I was not able to feel it at all, or the nurses were not able to feel it at all. So it was still, everybody was able to feel the pulse, so.
But from the chart, there's no specific quantification of the pulses.
That was not necessary.
But it's not in the chart, correct?
I object.
It's
She's
not
asking
in the chart,
a question.
But
go ahead.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, did you work with Dr. Jackson before this date? Okay. Generally, how do you and Dr. Jackson approach a patient who is injured either in an automobile collision or some other traumatic injury? How does the interaction between you and Dr. Jackson work with respect to the evaluation of the patient? Can you tell me what your responsibilities are versus what her responsibilities are in a general sense? And then I'll ask you what happened in this case.
I object. Go ahead.
I see the patient initially, then I go and describe it to Dr. Jackson. And then we both go from down there, like what test we want to order, what treatment we want to give.
Okay, so you do your initial physical evaluation of the patient.
Indicating yes for the record.
Yes.
Though it's not.
Okay, then you then find Dr. Jackson, wherever she might be in the emergency room. You discuss your findings with Dr. Jackson and ask Dr. Jackson if she agrees with the next course of treatment. Would that be a fair statement?
Yes.
Okay. And then if Dr. Jackson agrees, you go ahead with what you had originally wanted to do for the patient.
Yes.
Okay. Now, is that the procedure that you followed in this case?
Yes, but if she is not around and if I have to make any decisions, I do.
Okay, so you don't need her approval to go forward with your own treatment plan that you determined for the patient?
Yes.
Okay. Do you remember in this case whether you did ask for Dr. Jackson's assessment or simply went ahead with your own course of treatment for the patient?
No, I did ask before because we were ordering extensive x-rays. So I went ahead and I had discussed the case with her.
Okay.
And she was there and then she came in and herself evaluated the patient.
I'm sorry, she came where?
She came in herself.
She came in herself?
And she evaluated the patient too with me.
Do you remember that specifically?
Yeah, she evaluated the patient. I was right there in the room with her.
She did the exact same evaluation that you conducted on Mr. Tolson, she repeated that exact same evaluation?
I don't remember that details, but I mean she conducted the physical exam in her way.
Well, tell me what you saw her do.
She examined the whole leg, the knees, the leg, the foot, ankle, and she also tried to move and she felt it and she looked for the pulses.
She tried to move what parts of Mr. Tolson's body?
She just tried to examine. Move means she just was examining in the medical way.
Well, ma'am, I wasn't there, so I don't know what the word examine means. I'm asking you to be as specific as you can. If you can't remember, it's okay, but if you do remember, I need to explore and exhaust your memory on this issue. So if you can think back, if you can remember exactly what you saw her do and then tell me that.
I thought she just did.
No, yeah. She didn't.
Yes.
If you can be specific, I want to know from the time Dr. Jackson went into the examining room with you, with Mr. Tolson there, did she ask Mr. Tolson anything?
Yeah, she asked him the question, the mechanism of injury.
And what did Mr. Tolson tell her?
I do not remember. This is her usual way that she goes in, she will ask all the history questions, and she will do her own physical exam.
Okay. Now, if you don't remember what she asked, the next thing is, do you remember specifically the examination, or are you just telling me what she, your understanding of what she generally does for patients?
She generally does for the
okay.
patient.
So would it be fair to say, in this particular case, you can't recall specifically the exact type of examination that she performed on Mr. Tolson?
Yes.
All right. Now, did you recommend x-rays for Mr. Tolson?
Yes.
Okay. Why did you recommend an x-ray?
Because it was the injury. A door had fallen, he had swelling, he was not able to move his extremity. He didn't have the full range of motion.
So you were suspicious of a fracture?
Yes.
You're also suspicious of dislocation?
Yes.
Were you also suspicious of internal injuries to the structures supporting the knee, such as muscles, ligaments, tendons?
It could have been, but I mean, it's not in the emergency point of view that we were that much concerned of that. It's not life-threatening, I would say.
But what I'm trying to figure out, in your own mind, were you suspicious of these additional injuries that Mr. Tolson could have sustained as a result of the injury?
Object.
It could have been.
Do you know one way or the other?
I can't say. It could have been.
Could have been. Okay. If you were suspicious of injuries to the muscles, ligaments, and tendons, are there any other tests that you could have ordered to alleviate your suspicion of those injuries?
I object.
It was not necessary at that point of time.
Okay. Why wasn't it necessary at that point in time? If you were ordering an x-ray to see if he had a broken leg, to see if he had a dislocation of his leg or knee, why wasn't it necessary to order any additional tests to determine if other structures inside his knee were injured?
Because we are in the emergency, and we are not in the orthopedic clinic. So now a broken foot or a dislocated foot is something which we have to treat the patient right then and there. But I mean, the ligament and the tendon, it's not an emergency. We would not have been able to do much. We would have in any case asked him to go to orthopedic and get MRI from them. So it was not an emergency thing at that point of time.
Okay. Can you tell me, can you name the blood vessels that run down through the knee from the upper part of the leg to the lower part of the leg?
Popliteal artery is the main one.
Any other ones that you can think of?
It runs a popliteal, and then it separates into posterior tibial dorsalis pedis in the foot.
Okay. And is the popliteal artery, as it goes to the knee, is it in close proximity to the ligaments and tendons that also run through the back of the knee?
Yeah, it can be. Anatomy is mildly different in all the patients, so.
I'm talking about in a normal patient. Can you tell me how close the popliteal artery is with respect to the other ligaments that support the knee?
I cannot say exactly how close it is.
There's a difference between an inch and a foot. So we're talking about, I think, does the popliteal artery run along the back portion of the knee?
Yes.
Okay. Are there other ligaments that also, or tendons that also run along the back portion of the knee?
Yes.
Can you tell me what those are?
There are ligaments, tendons, collateral, like medial, meniscal, lateral meniscal, anterior, posterior, cruciate ligaments, collateral ligaments, and there are various tests to see the ligaments.
Is there also a popliteal tendon that runs along the back part of the knee as well?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is that a yes?
Yes.
Okay. Now, if a person has a traumatic injury to the knee, they could involve the ligaments, the tendons that are in the knee. Because the popliteal artery is close to those areas, is it possible that if a patient sustains an injury to the ligaments and tendons, that there's also trauma to the popliteal artery?
I object. Don't answer possibilities. Hey, rephrase your question, Mr. Gaston.
What did you learn in school regarding the chance of an artery running along the back part of the knee being injured if the ligaments and tendons also in that area are injured? What were you taught?
I object.
That's the reason neurovascular assessment comes first. That's the reason we see whether the patient has good pulses, and we go, that's the reason it comes first. And in this case, the patient had everything. Patient got proper care, what was needed. After all that was ruled out, we sent the patient for x-ray.
Okay. So the vascular assessment to assess the injury to the popliteal artery was conducted by the examination that you previously testified to, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Now, do Do you have any experience reading X-ray films?
I have a learning experience, but I always rely on the radiologist readings and the physician reading.
Your CV says you have extensive experience in performing skills that include interpreting imaging studies?
Yes, we did that during our rotations, during the 10 rotations that we have. So we do interpret it.
Okay, but you in your own profession always rely upon the radiologist's interpretation, and you don't render an independent interpretation yourself of an X-ray. Would that be a fair statement?
Yes, I go and see the X-ray. I say, okay, I see this, but whatever I note down in the chart, that is the radiologist's final report.
Okay, in this case, did you actually look at the X-ray?
I always look at all the X-rays.
Always look at the X-rays. Are you able to pick out a simple fracture in an X-ray?
Yes.
Are you able to pick out a dislocation in the X-ray?
Yes.
Are you able to determine whether a patient whose knee has been dislocated then goes back into the regular position? If you look at an X-ray that happens after that, are you able to determine whether or not the patient has previously sustained a dislocation that's went back into the normal position?
Yes. Object.
Most of the time.
Okay. In this case, when you looked at the X-ray, did you then reach a conclusion that Mr. Tolson did not have a previous dislocation that went back into place?
Object.
How would, I mean, if he had a previous, it's hard to know.
I think you said that you're able to determine that by looking at an X-ray?
No.
Okay.
I would make it clear. If the patient has come with a dislocation, we see, okay, this is dislocated, then we put it back in, and then we retake an X-ray. Okay, now it's put it in. In this case, it was nothing like that. We took the X-ray, there was no dislocation, there was no fracture.
Okay. Is there any way to determine from the X-ray that you saw whether Mr. Tolson had suffered a dislocation when the door came down on his knee and the knee went back into its regular
Absolutely
position?
Absolutely no.
No, okay. So you would never be able to make that determination?
No.
Okay. Now, so you looked at the X-ray films themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Did you see that there was fluid in the knee?
It is of no importance in this case because it could have been just from the injury.
Okay, so if the fluid in the knee had been from the result of the injury, it would not change any of your course of treatment?
No.
Okay, and you believe in this case, we do have a fusion. You're aware of that, correct?
Yes.
And do you believe that the effusion was more likely than not caused by the traumatic injury to his knee?
Yes.
Okay. Did you talk to the radiologist about the findings?
We get the reading of the radiologist. I did talk to him on phone, but we get the readings.
I'm sorry, did you say you did not talk to the
yes,
radiologist?
Yes, I did not.
Did not. Okay. So you received is it an electronic report?
It comes in the computer, the report.
Okay. Do you believe it's anything different than the actual written report that was dictated by Dr. Bang that was transcribed either the next day or 2 days after?
No.
Okay. All right.
You want to take a break? We've gone a little over an hour. You want to take a break? Are you okay? Does anybody want to take a break? Let me just...
I'm good.
Okay.
But I'll leave it up to...
No, I'm okay.
You all right? Okay. All right. Do you know whether Dr. Jackson came into the room to see Mr. Tolson before or after the X-rays were taken?
I cannot exactly remember, like, when she came in.
Is there any note in here that reflects Dr. Jackson's physical examination of Mr. Tolson?
She said that she agrees with my exam. There is one note saying that.
Right. My question is a little more specific. Is there anywhere in this chart where Dr. Jackson wrote down the results of her physical examination?
That's not needed.
She anticipated your next question.
Yeah, I know, but she didn't answer the one. My question was, again, is there anywhere in this note that reflects Dr. Jackson's physical examination of Mr. Tolson?
She agrees with my assessment, so that's what she has to write. There is no space in the chart, otherwise I mean to write her own. That's not the way the chart is designed.
Is the
so
answer
she has not written her physical.
Can you just answer?
Getting back to the question is real simple. Does her physical examination, the results, appear anywhere in the chart?
I object. You can answer it and then explain your answer if you want again.
Because it's not needed.
It's not needed. If it's not needed for her to put the physical examination and results in the chart, was there any need for her to examine Mr. Tolson?
Absolutely. If there was any change in the physical exam that she might have noted, which was missed, she would have noted that. So if everything was on the same line, she agreed to whatever I did, as we both discussed everything, then it's not necessary for her to mention the same thing again.
Okay. So is it your understanding that if her examination is different, then she writes in the chart that it's different?
If she has any other findings, she will.
She'll write it in the chart. And you've seen that in cases?
I don't remember each and everything, but if I think that's what she did.
Okay. Whose decision was it to administer pain medication to Mr. Tolson?
Dr. Jackson had ordered Dilaudid.
Are we on page 16?
Yes.
Did she also order Toradol?
Toradol, knee immobilizer, and crutches are my writings. But they were administered already. So sometimes what happens is when the patient comes in, if they are in pain, the nurses come and they ask the physician that so-and-so patient is in a lot of pain, and they will describe the patient to the physician, and they give the verbal order for the medications. And that's the way this medication might have been administered.
Okay, hold on a second. What time was the order for pain medication made in this case?
I wrote down when I thought of giving it, but I guess it was already administered at 15:27.
Okay, so it was administered before you actually saw Mr. Tolson a half hour later at 4 o'clock, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
That's what this shows.
Right. And do you know if Dr. Jackson actually saw or examined Mr. Tolson before she ordered the administration of the pain medication?
I don't know that.
Would she
at that time I had not seen the patient, so I didn't have the chart, anything, okay. So I don't know.
Was she required to at least examine Mr. Tolson before she administered, recommended, and ordered the Dilaudid?
I object.
I don't know.
Would you ever order Dilaudid for a patient that you never examined?
I object.
I would not have, but I mean, I would not order anything without examining the patient.
Okay. Now, and if Dr. Jackson had examined the patient and ordered Dilaudid before you saw the patient, would you expect there to be that note in the chart?
I object.
I don't know that part of it.
Well, in the experience in the emergency room at St. Agnes Hospital, if one of the doctors there who works with you day in, day out, had ordered Dilaudid 1 milligram IV for a patient, would you expect that doctor would have examined the patient before ordering that pain medication?
I object. Don't answer that. It's a general question, not responsive to, not relevant to this case.
Do you know what the protocol is at St. Agnes Hospital for a doctor ordering pain medication without seeing the patient?
I object.
I don't know.
Okay. But in your practice, you don't do it until you see the patient, correct?
I object.
No,
you don't do it. All right.
Where are you going?
Hang on a minute. I'll give you the page in one second.
Okay.
Yeah, let me find it first, sir, if I could. here we go. Ma'am, if you could go to page 19, please. Are you familiar with this part of the chart?
What page, I'm sorry?
Page 19.
19.
Yes.
Okay. Do you see where it says stated complaint left leg trauma?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Chief complaint priority 3, severity 9. Do you know what those categories mean and why they're used?
Severity of pain was 9 out of 10 and priority was 3.
Is that the level of triage?
No, triage level's at 4.
Triage level's at 4? And what's the priority 3 then? What does that refer to?
3, it could be either urgent care or main side.
I didn't understand it.
3, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 levels. 3 means it could fall either in the urgent care or on the main ER side. A patient can fall.
Okay, so this, so Mr. Tolson could have been seen either in the main emergency room or the urgent care in light of his level of priority.
Yes.
Okay.
But initially it was in the triad, no, it said 4.
She's referring to page.
Yeah, I see.
Okay.
I see it. Okay. Right. So someone made the determination. Someone made the determination to change the triage from a 4 to a 3. At some time, Mr. Tolson was in the emergency room.
I object. I don't know.
Okay,
well, don't answer
well,
that.
All right. Well, who made the note of a priority 3?
I have no idea.
Were you aware that the priority 3 had been in the chart at the time you examined Mr. Tolson?
No, this is not all in the chart when we have the patient. This is not all in the chart.
Okay. Do you see at the bottom where it says the X-rays were ordered at 3:27?
Yes.
Okay, and who ordered the X-rays?
It looks like Dr. Jackson.
Okay. Do you believe that that portion of the chart's accurate?
I object. No, she can tell that.
Do you have any reason to believe that the information in this chart on page 19 is inaccurate or false?
I object.
I have not seen this page, so I don't know.
Well, take a look at the page right now.
Yeah, I am, but okay. I cannot say anything on that day what happened because I'm not aware of this chart.
You're not aware of the chart?
Of this page.
This page?
This page.
Okay, have you seen this page before today?
I have.
Okay, when you saw the page before today, you looked at it. Did anything on this page suggest to you that the information on here was inaccurate or false when you saw it?
No, there's nothing inaccurate over there. It's very common when the nurses, they see the patient, they come immediately describe that patient has pain in the leg and can we order these X-rays on our assessment to the physician. And it's very common practice to do that.
Okay. All right. As a physician's assistant, do you need to have a supervising doctor in order to perform care and treatment for a patient in an emergency room here in Maryland?
Yes, a supervising physician has to be there.
Okay. And as a physician assistant, does a supervising physician have to sign a document that's filed with one of the agencies here that the supervising physician indicates that you are a physician assistant under their supervision?
I object. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm not going to permit or anything. I don't understand. You're talking about generally rules by the health department or hospital board or what?
I'm wondering if you're aware of any rule, regulation, requirement that a physician who supervises you has to file any paper with any administrative agency indicating that they are your supervising physician.
I object.
Aware of that?
If you know the answer.
No.
Okay. All right. At the time of Mr. Tolson's discharge, what was your final diagnosis for his medical condition?
I think what I wrote down was a sprain.
Okay.
Page 15, that was that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Did you, at that time, rule in or rule out any injury to any of Mr. Tolson's ligaments, muscles, or tendons in his knee joint?
That's why we asked him to follow up with the orthopedic doctor.
Well, my question is, did you rule in or rule out any injury to any of Mr. Tolson's ligaments, tendons, or muscles inside of his knee joint at that time?
I generally, after the fracture, patient was in pain, although after the medication his pain level was low, but we don't want to move around the joint too much because we don't want to further injure, if there was any injury to the ligament or tendon, we don't want to further injure it, so we don't try and test that in the ER.
Right, but my question again is, at the time of his discharge, did you rule in or rule out any injury to his ligaments, muscles, or tendons inside his knee?
Okay.
One way or the other.
Go ahead.
Yes, we generally, I try to ask the patient about how the patient is feeling, if there was any movement changes physically when the patient asked them to move their knees and ankle, and if there was any change in the way they move.
Okay, when you say yes to my question that you reached a decision whether you ruled in or ruled out any injury to his ligaments, muscles, or tendons, I'm trying to understand your answer because I didn't understand your answer. And the question is, and I'll ask it again, when you discharged Mr. Tolson, had you reached any decision at all, one way or the other, whether he had or did not have an injury to the muscles, tendons, and ligaments inside the knee when you discharged him?
Yes. Go ahead.
It's very hard to say at that point of time during the acute injury that the patient had.
Does that answer no, that you hadn't ruled in or hadn't ruled out those injuries?
Yeah, because it could be, it could not be. From the emergency point of view, we had ruled out whatever the emergencies were.
Okay. And at the time of his discharge, had you ruled in or ruled out any type of injury to the blood vessels inside of his knee?
Yes, that's why we did the neurovascular again before he left. After the immobilizer, we did it again.
Okay, now, and it's important to do it again before he left because even if he didn't have or present with a ongoing decrease in blood flow to his leg while you first saw him, that's why you do this examination before he leaves.
Yes.
And it's very important to do that examination.
Yes.
Do you remember if the lady who was with Mr. Tolson provided any information at all to you regarding his care? Do you remember one way or the other?
No, I have. It's mine. I just know that she was sitting there. I don't remember anything whether she asked or.
Did you ask Mr. Tolson if his leg was cold, or did you simply touch it yourself for the evaluation?
I asked him, and he denied. In the review of system, I've marked that cold extremity denied.
Okay.
And I touched it too during my course of examination.
Okay. Did you, when Dr. Jackson came in to examine Mr. Tolson, did you hand Dr. Jackson his chart so she could look at it before the examination?
I don't remember.
Would you have had the chart with you at that time?
Yes.
Okay. So if Dr. Jackson had wanted to look at the chart, you could have easily handed it to her for her to review?
Yes.
Do Have you had patients before who come into the emergency room where the initial examination is that they have adequate pulses, but by the time they leave, something has changed in their medical condition to the point where the pulses have been decreased?
I object.
I don't remember, like, at the top of my head, but I've seen many patients, and that can happen.
Okay. All right. Thank you. That's all the questions I have.
Now, we will read and sign the deposition.
Okay.
You're all done.
Here marks the end of volume one, tape number one, the deposition of Michelle Krupa Shah. Going off the record, the time is 11:25 a.m.
You say Michelle.